it. So it starts here. And that is why, you know, a lot of steps are all interrelated, and that's why we call it a cyclic, you know, disaster management cycle. You have minimum standards of relief guidelines established by the National Disaster Management Authority. You can always get an access to what it says. So you have guidelines mentioned for state specific actions. You have state guidelines also. So if it's a big disaster event, what is required is that initial 1 to 3 days, the states can try and do whatever best they can. From the 4th day to 10th day onwards, try and follow the minimum standard guidelines established specifically, if they can try and do that. And if you think that the disaster is even bigger and it's going to exceed 10 plus days, then it is sort of mandatory to follow the guidelines which are established. Of course, there is scope for a lot of flexibility. You know, because the guidelines prescribe the demand for drinking water, for hygiene, health concerns, the space to be allocated for, you know, the relief camps and all. And you have the terrains are very different in different places. So it is not possible to rigidly follow the guidelines which are prescribed. So obviously, there's a lot of scope for flexibility given to it. But nonetheless, if the event, if the disaster event exceeds 10 days, then you have to kind of follow these guidelines established. And then you have another important aspect, which is the long-term measure. Why long-term? Because it calls in for a lot of brainstorming. It requires community to be mobilized and made a part of it, because it's eventually for the respective community that you're going to plan something new. It also involves a lot of funding to be made a part of it, and that's the reason it sometimes takes a lot of time to be kind of designed and then implemented. And it encompasses two components. One is the reconstruction part of it, wherein we talk about the physical infrastructure to be rebuilt, and this time maybe built better. And how you can do this is by incorporating some of the structural mitigation aspects, and in non-structural, maybe understanding what the bylaws and building laws and codes suggest for different states. So you can have access to all of that and try and incorporate structural and non-structural mitigation initiatives for a build back better scenario. Parallelly, people have lost their you know, earning opportunities, they have lost their assets, they have lost their livelihood opportunities. So you need to think of ways to give them some alternative mechanism. Again, this requires a lot of brainstorming. If it's a farmer, you cannot expect him to take up something which doesn't, you know, which is a very, very different kind of a livelihood opportunity, because he may not be used to that kind of a aspect. So maybe something related to, on the lines of farming, where the person can relate to the kind of work he or she is doing. You have a lot of challenges when it comes to this, you know, taking up reconstruction and rehabilitation measures. There are ample examples where good strategies have been designed for reconstruction, yet people don't adhere to them, or are not in a position, are not ready to, you know, move to safer zones, and they always want to go back to where they originally belonged to. There are examples post tsunami when people, when the fishing communities were advised and given places to be, you know, shifted to different sites, and they were not ready to leave the seaside. Similar examples from Uttarakhand had come up after the 2013 floods, that people were not ready to leave the original sites, which were otherwise marked as risk prone. All right, so there are challenges attached to it, and that's the reason why you need a lot of community members to be made a part of it. Now, in this entire cycle, so you need to figure out where all the PRI institution can play a role. A is definitely immediately when a disaster strikes, and that is where we also talk about the community empowerment aspect, wherein we try and say that because it's the initial few hours, sensitive hours, the best which we can respond to that disaster situation, how many lives we can try and save, or you know, to we can cater to injured people, will also decide the extent of damages and losses. So this is one place where you know, community volunteers and community disaster management teams can be prepared, and this falls under the perhaps the zoning of the Panchayati Raj levels. This is a very important area. Definitely, in other aspects also, some of these teams, I'll show one of the slides where you can form different teams here. And of course, when it comes to reconstruction rehabilitation, and you're involving the community and the community leaders, so the Panchayati Raj is one area that can perhaps facilitate this kind, this process between the governments, between the other stakeholders, as well as the community in question. So here also they can play a role. Not that they do not play roles here, but you have you know, defined places wherein we're all community members or Panchayati Raj can be involved. And this is also the place wherein, you know, a lot of state schemes and centrally sponsored schemes can be integrated with disaster management opportunities, right? So if you are looking at some rural development scheme in terms of housing, in terms of infrastructure or mobility and all, you can always try and integrate structural mitigation, correct? So that's what we are trying to perhaps you know, advocate here in this area of the combination of the Gram Panchayat development plans with disaster management aspects. So that is one way to do that. So convergence is something that we are trying to advocate here. So let's just look at how you know, the Panchayati Raj or the community-based disaster risk management area can be integrated with the Gram Panchayat development plan, which is otherwise a separate entity, but the role responsibility lies with the PRI levels to develop those plans. Okay, it is a process to the whole idea of community-based disaster risk management or risk reduction. Now we use the term DRR more as compared to DRM. But the whole idea is to enhance the capacities, right? We need to understand the different hazards, the different subsequent disasters that may occur, and the vulnerabilities that are present. But more so, based on the you know, the analysis, the inventory of these aspects, the hazard vulnerability aspects, you need to enhance the capacities at the local levels. So that is the prime idea behind doing it. Because you involve the community members, it is designed by the community because it's for your own areas. You own it, and when you own it, you kind of are made accountable to it. Perhaps this can be seen as a way to sustain such activities, you know. Otherwise, a lot of times when it's done from an outside agency or from an outside organization, what happens is after a while it all fizzles out, and such initiatives, they you can do hand holding definitely to give that guidance, but if you make the community the owner of such initiatives, it may perhaps sustain for a longer time. It also helps in you know, adding on to the efficiency of response, which I had mentioned in the previous slide also. Definitely try and maintain an inventory of what best manpower in terms of capacity that is available at the community level. When I say community level, it is the panchayat and the lowest, most, you know, the grassroots levels. So that inventory can be made of people who are trained in different aspects. Please remember, when we talk about community-based disaster management or DM plannings, and preparedness at the community level, the idea is that they only play a supportive role. We do not expect them to directly go and perform a lot of these tasks. So if we say search and rescue, we definitely can train few volunteers in conducting it. But then the idea is only for them to play a supportive role to the teams that actually are technically trained to conduct such search and rescue operations. But because the community members are aware of their own areas, they can be facilitators and play a more supportive role in smoothly conducting such search and rescue operations. All right. There are now funding provisions even made at the Panchayati level. If being given that much of an empowerment, and funding provisions are available at that levels to be utilized for such initiatives. it's easy for them to reach to the community. They are perhaps the direct linkages for the district, state, and the national levels to reach to communities actually through the PRIs. So for us, that's the reason why PRIs, that level plays an important role. And of course, what we've been trying to discuss here is the development plans of the village can be integrated smoothly with the disaster management plans. Other roles that the community-based DRR initiatives can be, harnessed for are maybe in different awareness campaigns. Members like Asha members, Anganwadi members, they have a reach at each household levels. So if you are trying to, if they are trying to promote health hygiene, they can also try and tell people about the right way of wearing a mask, the right way of washing and keeping yourself clean, the importance of personal hygiene, the importance of maintaining social distances, and likewise when you are dealing with a disaster. So you can integrate their ongoing work profiles with some of the activities or measures that can be incorporated for awareness generation for disasters. So maybe in the for the pandemic context, this can be integrated. From the context of maybe different disasters, few other awareness measures can be incorporated. So that is what all needs to be integrated is something that needs to be chalked out when you are sitting with the community and planning the work. Okay. Training at the Gram Panchayat block level members is important. Identification of these village volunteers, conducting sensitization meetings. Why sensitization meetings? Because their priorities are different. You and I, for Shekharji and myself, for us right now, it's very important that we take up this particular area at each, state level. But it may not be the priority for people, at the grassroots levels. Their priorities might be something else. So how can we kind of mobilize them to be a part of such initiatives? That can be only done first through sensitization. So for any initiative, I'll be quoting a couple of examples also in the last of regarding convergence schemes. Therein, sensitization and awareness campaigns have played a very big role in eventually giving the positive bent to such initiatives. And then you can go in for some, if you have identified the best volunteers for certain aspects at the village levels, you can go in for their specialized trainings. And of course, this is something we again harp upon, women participation. Women groups in a lot of places, in a lot of examples, post a lot of disasters, women groups have they have come out, they have emerged very strongly in terms of sustaining their initiatives, especially the self-help groups of in South India. A lot of women self-help groups have done wonderfully well post tsunami and post a lot of other disasters, and they sustain also very long. One reason could be that the men groups, which are generally formed, are temporary in nature because they have lost their actual livelihood opportunities. So they temporarily form self-help groups to sustain their household incomes. And once things are a little back to normalcy, they kind of annul the groups, and then they go back to their own original professions. But when it comes to women self-help groups, they take up hobbies as their income generating opportunity sources, and that's the reason why such groups sustain. And these groups can be then made an integral part of maybe such village volunteer teams, or training them at for certain specific tasks. So such groups can be kind of utilized. All right, what you can do is, there are certain aspects, so we'll just see one by one, which needs to be done at the panchayati level. And eventually all these 5-6 steps that you are seeing, they need to be integrated in the disaster Gram Panchayat development plan. How this will be integrated, I'll show a little later. So what are the things you need to do? Go in for hazard mapping of that area. The community can do that through a visual representation, through maybe rough sketching, an overview, through you know, looking back at the history of the place, discussing with the elders of the place, you know, people who are 70, 75, 80 plus years old, they can talk about what they had experienced in their early, you know, young ages or in their childhoods. So that can also be a part of it, because when we are making a hazard mapping, when we're doing hazard mappings, we encourage that A, have an inventory of the hazards which are visible, which perhaps have had an impact in the recent past for that place, and also to dig into the history of that place and look at some of the hazards which perhaps had caused some sort of an impact maybe many, many years ago. But not to forget that there can always be a recurrence, you know, period for them. And then thirdly, have, you know, some amount of presumptions also added to these scenarios. With especially when we are talking in terms of the changing weather and climate patterns. So with that, there's the dynamism of, you know, the weather variations are changing. So you are having erratic rainfalls, you are having places which are drought prone converting into flood areas. So have some amount of presumptions also done in your hazard mappings that probably not today, but maybe in the coming years, our area can face one such kind of a, you know, disaster situation also. So through that, on a sheet, maybe you can do a good hazard mapping for that area. Like this is also from what community village members generally do. How was my place earlier and now how it has turned and how that is going to impact that area in terms of disasters that can be mapped. History profile, like I said, through storytelling and finding out what was the intensity of a particular X event that occurred maybe 10 years ago or 15, 20 years ago. So from the elders, you can get a lot of insight into such historic profile of that place. This is one another good way at the community level, you know, to form, to make calendars of different hazards and their subsequent impacts on the different profiles. For example, this is just an example on how the different hazards of one place can have an impact on maybe just the kind of crops, or, you know, as one farm products. And likewise, you can have details chalked out here of other work profiles also for that area. It depends upon what kind of livelihood opportunities the village community members are, they are actually practicing. And based on that, what are the different hazards present in that area and how this will then get impacted. So, and definitely this is something which cannot be formed by one person. It calls in for the community members to be sitting together along with people, you know, volunteers from outside or maybe trained personnel from outside who can help them develop this kind of a seasonal calendar. So a seasonal calendar also gives a very quick insight into, you know, what is the hazard scenario for that area. And in case a hazard occurs regularly, how subsequently it may turn into a disaster site and cause a detrimental impact. All right. Equally important is to also have an analysis of the different vulnerabilities that are present in one given place. Especially we are talking of the Gram Panchayat level. So here at village levels, what kind of vulnerabilities are present in terms of their locations, in terms of the social bifurcation that is present, in terms of the economic status, the livelihood opportunities people have, or their income sources, and also in terms of the environmental vulnerabilities. There are zones across India which are environmentally very, very vulnerable, and we generally tend to not look at environmental you know, destruction as a part of this disaster management, but it definitely calls in for that inclusive approach as well for the flora and fauna species that are present. Maybe if you look at the Andaman Nicobars, even Puducherry for that matter, the coastlines, you know, you have endemic special species of plants, animals which are native to certain places, and you may tend to lose them, or they may become extinct due to various reasons, especially if there is degradation of the environment taking place. And if it is happening because of a disaster situation, then that needs to be accounted for as well. You know, just a food for thought, if I ask you all to give a valuation to an endemic plant species or an insect species that has now become extinct, which was earlier a part of that a particular ecosystem, then what kind of value would, you know, economic valuation would you be able to give to that? If, you know, if you look at Delhi, we now don't see sparrows anymore here. Sparrows are almost vanished from Delhi. So what, how not having sparrows in Delhi will have an impact on the chain that it was a part of in the ecosystems. You know, these are all challenging areas to work upon, but definitely just think about it. So that's the reason why environmental conservation should be made a part of your village level plannings and also of disaster management plans. So environmental vulnerability also plays an important role. So how best can you do that? You can do it by actually going around that places that you can make. You can take small areas as your, the zones for which you would be doing a vulnerability assessments, and spatially explore them, see how the land use patterns are, how the houses are constructed, what kind of housing, whether they are well connected or not, mobility, commutation, what kind of commutation concerns are there or not. I've traveled across Odisha and the Andhra coastlines, and within a span, just a area of 2 kilometers, the vulnerabilities, they change variably. You know, there are fishing communities right across the sea line, and then within 2 to 3 kilometers inside, when you move towards the plain land, you have villages which are relatively more safer, relatively more well connected. Likewise. So very quickly, these vulnerability patterns would change, and that is why you need to identify very small locations, and then identify what are the vulnerable elements present there. Okay. So by observing, maybe by asking, talking to people, what kind of livelihoods they practice, what kind of opportunities they have, and how much understanding of hazards, vulnerabilities. Does the community members know, or they are ignorant about, and how they perceive risks, how they see their hazards, approaching hazards, and likewise. So that gives an insight into how well informed the community is, or whether the need for awareness generation is very high, the need for sensitizing such communities is very high or not. Two villages, we had done a comparative study in Odisha for cyclones, and the fishing village, because they had very close proximity to the sea, they were obviously much more at concern. Secondly, because they were marooned, they were not very close to the plain land, information reaching to them was also very less as compared to one of the villages which was in the plain land inside. Those villages were very well informed about which route to take when heavy wind speeds occur, or when they start getting, they used to also, they said that they also used to get timely informations, warning messages, whereas the fishing community, it never reached them because they were so secluded. So that makes them more vulnerable as compared to the Sardar community, right? And then they were also aware, the plain land community was very well aware, which are the shelter sites meant for them, where they can move to safety, whereas the fishing community did not have that information. Okay, so you can just make a rough sketch, look at the exposure of that place, from where does, if you have a seaside to that village, then that also makes it vulnerable. What kind of surroundings are present for that village or for that block. So likewise, you can take up such vulnerable assessment studies. Okay. Yes, you need to integrate the vulnerable groups, extremely important, be it small children, the pregnant ladies, the lactating feeding mothers, they become an equally important component to that. We keep repeatedly harping this, because when you are then planning for those areas, when you are designing schemes for that places, based on the kind of vulnerable groups that are present, your schemes and designs need to have certain aspects specially earmarked for these special groups. Okay, so if you have differentially abled members and within the community, when you are designing some developmental plans for them, what kind of opportunities can be provided to this group? And if then there is a disaster, that is hampering that development, then how would it have an additional impact on this particular group? and how you can take care of that. So maybe through education for children, the pandemics have given us so many insights and lessons for how the toddlers and the adolescents have become vulnerable, you know, because of that lack of 1 year of direct formal education, and how the youth has been impacted by it also in terms of, you know, mental stress and worrying for their future, and also how, what kind of changes or reforms are required in the education policies. How are the it's a big challenge for governments to even restart their schools. There are government schools where even sitting arrangements, trying to maintain the social distance is a concern, where you have 80-90 students in one small class, housed in one small classrooms. So there are challenges for to even reopen your schools, something very basic. So if you dig deep into such concerns, you would come out with so many more concerns for this vulnerable section, the small children or even the elder ones. And then whatever you need to design for them will require different strategies and plans. Likewise for the elders and the other vulnerable groups also. So, and that is the reason, I'm just quoting a few examples, but this is the reason why in your developmental planning also, you always tend to, include the vulnerable groups. And because of disasters, the impact on them is much higher. And this makes it even more important that you address their concerns. Okay, there's another very good way when you're doing a group work, a group activity, when there are many members sitting together and trying to, chalk out some of their concerns. You can do it by making a problem tree. So, you can have the trunk can be one of your problems, right? So it can be a flooding scenario for that village. That can be one of the problems. And then what are the causes of that problem will be the roots. What are the different reasons why that flooding situation occurs in that village can be the roots of that problem. And what is it leading to? Whether it is leading to a lot of debt, whether it is leading to migration, or if it is drought scenario, whether malnourishment is happening, the problem of reverse migration was seen a lot during the COVID situation. So that can be the effects, the impacts of that problem. So likewise, when these exercises are very good to be taken up when you are actually sitting with large groups. Okay. Also to take into account are the different resources, because eventually, if you remember, I started with the slide saying that the need is to enhance capacities. So if you need to enhance capacities, you also need to have an inventory of what are the already available capacities, and based on what are the different vulnerabilities present, what would be the requirements to deal with that hazards and the vulnerabilities. So what the gaps can then be identified, right? So in terms of manpower, that we lack a lot of basic trainings can be one of the identified gap in a capacity. That our area is very prone to flooding every year. And we really solely depend upon external support to come and move us to safe sites. And so why not at the panchayat level, can we make provisions of few boats so that, at least the vulnerable groups are moved to safety, something like that, just quoting an example. So these are some of the gaps that can then be analyzed when you are chalking out your hazards, vulnerabilities and resources. All right. Needless again to say, this always should be a part of all your plans, the drill aspect to it, because this is kind of testing it. It's a very sensitive aspect. Never ever would be encouraged to encourage individual organizations or individual schools to just take them up. No, that's not the right way to do it. It's always good to have the panchayat made a part of it, the local administration members made a part of it, or they are at least kept in loop. The best is to have the district administration, write to the district administration to kind of monitor if you wish to go in for conducting one such drills for your, maybe for your area. Maybe you just want to test a evacuation drill. Maybe you have tried to sensitize people about the different alert messages, warnings, sirens for that area. and you want to test it whether people actually pay attention when you play sirens or when you put an alarm. So if you want to do an evacuation drill and test those alarm systems, so don't just take up those initiatives on your own. Always take the help of the technical, the ones who are legally made mandated to conduct drills. Be a part of such drills. They are very well trained in it. They know the nitty-gritty, and they also know what can be the concerns attached with conducting drills. So drills is a subject, so I'm not going directly into what the whole subject of mock drills is about, but please always remember and keep this in mind whenever you are taking up small drills also, local drills also, even if it means a fire drill. Even if you have people trained in your area, in your school, in your hospital premises for fire safety, whenever you're conducting a drill, always, always advise that involve the fire brigade people with it, for it. All right, so don't conduct it on the road. Yes, community contingency fund is important. Panchayati, sir, the Panchayati Raj levels, they have their own very many ways of generating funds at that level. And now with the 15th Finance Commission, there are provisions made even in the constitutional in the constitutional amendments, provisions have been made for the Panchayati Rats to enhance their powers by giving them some funding scopes and mechanisms to carry out such initiatives. So while Gram Panchayat Development Plan is like, you know, that is something the PRI ministry or the PRI members have to make it, all you need to do is make provisions for integration of certain disaster management specific concerns of that area, just integral to those developmental plans. That's all we are trying to kind of say here. At each level, encourage people to have emergency kits at each household level, maybe at the panchayat levels, definitely for villages which are secluded, which may get marooned, which may get detached during an emergency times. It is important for people to manage up to a level until the external help reaches them. So for that, the best way is to have the supplies of certain important components which will help them survive for a while until help reaches them. So such kits can be very handy. Make these kits gender sensitive, which means the keeping in mind the needs of maybe pregnant ladies and feeding mothers or young adolescent girls, or even the shaving kits and all for men for their personal hygiene. And also we are now advocating that have your kits be made very gender sensitive as well. This is just examples of how structural mitigation needs to be done. What is the importance of a participatory learning? Like if you are going in for a hazard mapping or vulnerability assessment with the community members, in the picture you can see all women group doing it. They know their places well. So that's the idea when you're involving the community for such initiatives, making local resources. This is an example I always quote, because I feel for, especially at the panchayat levels, at the village level plannings, maybe this is something that can be taken care of. Like I was mentioning, you have vulnerable section within your communities, and we have seen a lot of places. Bihar gets flooding every year. Even for coastlines, cyclones are a concern, floodings are a concern. And there are very many villages, which get totally marooned. For the help to reach them also, it takes a lot of time. Even Jammu Kashmir saw a very intense, flooding in 2014, in the month of September. And that was the setting in of the winter season also. So when you're making a kit, you need to also keep in mind, the kind of season and the kind of season that is going to set in. And it obviously needed 2-4 months of relief provisions. Because you have vulnerable sections, you have small children, you may be having pregnant mothers amongst that community members who may need food much earlier, or some basic facilities much earlier as compared to other healthy adults around. These communities, a lot of such communities which know that they kind of get cut off during major disasters, in the pre-monsoon season itself, they start storing some food grains for themselves, so that at least they can take care of themselves until external help reaches. So this concept of community granary is very good. This can be actually, you know, taken up and promoted also in a lot of places where you feel that such similar needs may be important. Okay, these are just some of the examples. Now, this is also mandatory as per the Act. So you need to have village disaster management committees formulated. And with the help of the committees, you need to have mandatorily the formation of disaster management teams at the panchayat levels. You can have such segregated teams for specific activities or depending upon the manpower resources that are available, which you have identified. I had mentioned it in one of the earlier slides. You can have combinations. So maybe sanitation first aid can be one team, maybe evacuation and search and rescue warning can be one team. So you need to identify members from within your villages who you think would be apt to take up such tasks, you know, maybe in the pre-stage, during the disaster stage, or post-disaster stage. Okay, now this particular activity actually is best when you are doing face-to-face trainings, and you know, we can actually sit together and identify what kind of role responsibilities each team member can play in the pre-disaster scenario and in the post-disaster scenario. Who would be the best members you can identify at the village or panchayat levels who can play that particular role very well. So keeping that in mind, such disaster management teams can be formulated. So in the Gram Panchayat Development Plan, maybe this can be one good component integrated along with hazard risk, vulnerability and capacity assessment that I had just mentioned earlier. Okay. So likewise, you can have different teams and their role responsibilities very well defined within the village level plannings or even in the Gram Panchayat plans that you have. Okay. So these are just some of the examples, counseling teams, you can have members who can help in doing a damage assessment for that area, what was the livestock assessment, if it's fishing, boats, plantations, and likewise. So such teams can be formulated. Moving on, how this can be, you know, these components of disaster management be integrated at the Gram Panchayat Development Plan that calls in for that local level planning. So at the Gram Panchayat or the GPDP levels, you have 29 subjects on which you can actually take up different activities. These are the 29 areas. If you actually look at them, say education, can we not kind of just integrate? This is the for the village developers, the panchayat development areas, right? At the Gram Panchayat levels, for the rural or maybe the rural areas, these are the 29 subjects on which schemes and projects can be implemented. So can we not look at vocational education or adult and non-formal education as a way wherein you can take up some awareness generation activity for cyclones or for floods or for making those emergency kits like I had mentioned, or for just sensitizing them on the gender needs. So something like that, that's easier to do, right? Similarly, can we not take up activities here if you're making a rural electrification? Can it not have some component of alert messages or warnings attached with infrastructure? So something like that. So there are these 29 areas wherein you can think of integrating some mitigation, preparedness, or preventive measures of disaster management. But what needs to be done is actually look at the priorities. So there are ample things that you can actually take up, but based on, you know, what is the necessity of that place, which are the 3, 4, 5 most severe concerns a particular X place has in question, you can take up certain activities. All right. This is what I was just referring to, that the 2018 guidelines of Gram Panchayat Development Plans has made it mandatory that you have disaster management included and made a part of it. And how can you do it? I think I somehow missed that slide. Just a second. Just give me a second. So it is missing. Just give me one second. I just wanted to show you when a Gram Panchayat development plan is prepared, where exactly can you integrate this DM aspect. Okay. Sorry for this bit of a goof up. Okay, so here, when a Gram Panchayat development plan is prepared, this is how you generally take it up. All right, so you have the Gram Panchayat plan facilitation team formed. Now, this is very clear to the Panchayati Raj Ministry and the people who actually go in and implement the Gram Panchayat plans. All right, so this is in the initial Gram Sabha, you have this facilitation team formed. You discuss what would be the concerns of that area in terms of development. You do community mobilization and involvement of the community members for development aspects, like what are our concerns, what are we lacking, what good examples somebody must have heard from someplace from the community and they would want to kind of replicate it. Collection of a lot of primary and secondary data is carried out for the development agenda. And this is also the place wherein you can do some primary and secondary data collection for your hazard mapping, for your vulnerability assessment, and for analyzing the capacities that you have, which I just explained it in the detail, right? So when you're doing it for the development part, you can also do it for the disaster management aspect. Then you do a situation analysis, which means based on whatever information that you have collected, the inventory that you have developed, you would analyze what kind of situations will be formed. Or from the developmental perspective, what is required for the benefit of the village and villages. And from a disaster management perspective, some of the priority concerns that you have that can be analyzed. You sit and do a visioning exercise again, that is for what kind of schemes and projects that will need to be designed and implemented in that area. And parallelly, this is also the place wherein you can also now do the prioritization of the disasters or specific concerns and integrate some of the strategies to manage that. Maybe in terms of mitigation, structural mitigation, you might be requiring, and for that, you would be requiring specific funds, right? So, or maybe in terms of maybe sensitization, awareness, preventive measures, early warning measures, you may suddenly realize that your village, even in the near vicinity, the village, there are absolutely no safe shelters, multi-purpose shelters available. So, which means, A, you need to identify the right place where the shelter can be constructed, it is safe, and B, the construction of the shelter would also require funding. All right, so that can go as a part of the strategy, the plan that you have prepared. It goes for the plan goes for approval and then subsequently for implementation and monitoring. So this is how you take up certain developmental activities at the Gram Panchayat level for financial year or likewise, and this is exactly wherein you can also go in for a integration with the DM plans with it. So some of the just examples I've quoted in terms of grasslands, in terms of the desertified lands, can we look for ways to use those lands for certain different purposes, earthquake proof civil constructions if can be taken up, or maybe for coastlines if we can look for shelter beds, bioshield components. Post tsunami, it was realized that mangroves really helped some of the villages in Tamil Nadu. So mangrove reforestation projects were taken up in big ways across a lot of coastline in India. So if bioshields can provide that protection and parallelly also give some kind of livelihood opportunities also as a like a joint forest management kind of a concept, or windbreak plantations can be done near the where you have sand dunes and the coastlines and all. So just quoting few examples of how this can play. So I'll share this slide this presentation also with you all to just go through those 29 subjects. Which are the concerned ministries, what kind of deliverables in terms of developmental activities can be taken up, and parallelly, if there is scope to integrate small disaster management components in them. Like somebody had just written about local fairs and all. Absolutely wonderful ways of promoting some of the basic awareness components. Some do's and don'ts for some very critical hazards or disasters that the community faces. You can utilize such fairs, local fairs, as an opportunity wherein you provide them with scope to kind of showcase their, you know, promote their livelihoods and give them some earning opportunities. And parallelly, those can also be utilized for such purposes, the disaster management perspective, I'd say. So maybe poverty alleviation program, so rural development ministry, and how this MNREGA, I'll quote one example of how MNREGA scheme has been used for protection from floods in Assam. So likewise, so some of the examples are given here. So these can be utilized. Based on, now this is this plethora of information, there's no dearth of it. So please be specific depending upon your area, the concerns, the kind of vulnerabilities, the kind of vulnerable groups that are present there. You need to design certain deliverables. All right. Not that any and everything would play a role. Just few examples. Areas wherein you can go in for such convergence, different ministries and different sectors which can be roped in for convergence purposes. All right. Some of the flagship programs that are ongoing, wherein you can look for opportunities to have better reconstruction integrated measures or better mitigation measures integrated or training and capacity building. And like I had mentioned, the 15th Finance Commission has made provisions at the state levels, fundings, segregated, you know, provisions for 30%, I think, is for reconstruction and rehabilitation. 20% is funding can be utilized for mitigation activities. From 5%, it has now been increased to 10% for training and capacity building. So these are some of the aspects wherein, you know, you can look in for different rural schemes, which are ongoing at the panchayati levels, where you can look for ways to do convergence for disaster management activities also. Some examples, you know, how rivers are rejuvenated, flood assessments are done. So there are examples here. I wish to quote one very good example. See, this is also very nice way where, you know, people have tried to safeguard their livelihood opportunity. It's like a goat farm. So, you know, every year, maybe because of cyclones or maybe because of some wind speeds, they used to lose their livestock. So how they can safeguard that? This is another example from Karnataka, wherein the villages, you know, they used to have the problem of seawater intrusion and salinity was a concern for them. So how they created another pond, an artificial pond, and how the water was then screened out so that, you know, they could utilize that water for farming purposes. This is another example from Assam, where, you know, this village is very, very close to the Brahmaputra, and it gets flooded up to this height. You know, the houses, the huts, they get, you know, flooded in that water every year. And look at the condition of even the water sources. This was something that we had also noticed in many places in UP, wherein, you know, the farmlands, they get flooded because of floodwaters every year. And then subsequently, they have epidemics as concerns. And if this is going to be, you know, your sanitation, look at the health and sanitation concern. So when we were working with one of the BDO groups in UP, they had recommended that why can't we just elevate the hand pump, you know, heights to a level where it will not get a lot of, you know, impacted by that flood water or that mud and silt that comes after it. So the small examples that can be taken. So they have a lot of such concerns. One coping mechanism that they follow is within very small patch, they grow multiple crops. I couldn't capture it very well in this picture, but, you know, if you look at only this picture, they have about 8 to 10 different vegetables and fruits grown. So the idea is that if one or two do not sustain their fruits and vegetables, at least there will be something available at each given time in the year for them to eat. All right. And this was one of the convergence schemes taken up. A 14-kilometer long embankment is being created very close to this village. This hut is just adjacent here. It's just here. So, you know, the MNREGA had provided them with the labor force, and then they had another smaller other schemes which provided some of the fundings, and they were making this embankment for that case. So small convergence can definitely help. This is about one of the examples of rivulet rejuvenation in UP, and almost 46 kilometer long. The initial concern was that it was already habitated by a lot of people. The original route was not being tracked easily. People were not supporting because they had already grabbed the land. So they had to, you know, reach out to the panchayati level and request them to kind of you know sensitize, make people aware about the long term benefit of reviving that rivulet. And eventually, you know, it was the initiative by actually one of the district collectors in 2013. And under MNREGA itself, you know, they tried to rejuvenate this, and after a while, they got results also. So for a long term, this benefit then lasts. Again, Majuli Islands, you can read about Majuli Islands. They're already shrunken to a very great extent, and how people were losing out on their farming practices, and then only the only livelihood opportunity was farming, and how they've now started growing you know, vegetables and herbs in water, actually. And these are called hydroponics. So in water, they grow these vegetables and herbs. Almost 600 farmers have taken this up, and their incomes has multiplied 3 times. So, you know, again, it is by the initiative of a couple of schemes, integrating those schemes so that these farmers were trained in that. They were given some skill-based trainings to develop such hydroponic trays and all, and also grow these vegetables and herbs. So some possible areas from the 29 places wherein you can go in for such possible convergence in the Gram Panchayat development plans. Some areas, maybe sericulture, social welfare schemes, definitely small irrigation facilities. Water is a concern almost in every region, and even state-wise if you look at it. So maybe water-based projects and programs can be tapped in for better, even from a disaster management perspective also. So I think that is all from my end. So this is just, the idea was just to give some insight and highlight about, you know, the importance of this integration which is required. And what we are now from this coming year onwards would encourage us, let's take up, you know, face-to-face trainings for Panchayati Raj Institution and their members, involving the state institutes of perhaps the rural developments who can take up the training component of it. And the Panchayati Raj members have been of a lot of states which have already started this initiative, Telangana, Sikkim, UP, Himachal. These are some of the states which have already started doing this integration, because, you know, I think they have to submit the first GPDP draft sometimes in, I think, January or February now, 2021. So they were wanting ideas of how disaster management can be integrated in it. So I think because it is mandatory, this is one way I foresee that we can take up some trainings at the SIRD levels for each state, and maybe they can do some hand holding for their own respective Panchayati Raj departments so that these two areas can be integrated. Thank you. That's all from my end. Any queries, questions?
Thank you. Thank you, Dr. Sushma, for presentation on mainstreaming DRR and disaster risk management into Gram Panchayat Development Plan, and focusing on topics such as community-based disaster management to enhance the capacity at local level, women's participation, hazard mapping, seasonal calendar, tools for vulnerability analysis, and cycle or GPDP. We have one of our participants who would want to ask question.
Hello.
Please go ahead.
Yes, it's a pleasure to actually listen to the session on PRIs and GPDP by Sushma Ma'am and Shekhar Chaturvedi sir. And I think a lot has been discussed, and I think clarity on most of the issues. But I have basically two particular questions. Let me introduce myself. I'm Sardar Ramiz from Kashmir, a regular participant in the NIDM sessions. So I wanted to ask the panelists, especially Sushma Ma'am, that we have our PRI system, a very nascent and very newly formed. And one more addition to our structure is the Zilla Parishads, you see. We had recently elections to that. And now we have a robust structure to that, but it is very nascent, you see. So two questions. One, what is the financial mechanism of disaster management plan for Panchayati Raj institutions? I mean, what will be the arrangement, structural arrangement of financial arrangement of this? To have disaster management plan implemented, executed in the PRIs, number one. And number second is that what kind of other capacity building trainings will be undertaken from NIDM per se or any national institution for Panchayati Raj institutions to train them in the disaster management plan. So one on financial arrangement, what kind of arrangements, especially reference to our finance commission recent allocations. And number second is the capacity building. What could more be done from top, from NIDM and other institutions? Thank you so much.
Okay. Thank you, Ramiz. And I think, Ramiz, you are already a good resource person. Seeing your interest in the area, it's glad to see some people with so much of interest. So first part, see, PRI is not nascent. And I'll then ask request Shekharji also to give his inputs. PRI structure and PRI establishment as a governance, local governance, is not nascent. Definitely trying to integrate the disaster management into it, maybe. All right. We as national institutes, and when we work with states also, we realize that the subject of disaster management to be taken at that level, at the panchayat levels or at the village level, is still at a very nascent stage. All right. Village plans are not formed for a lot of states from the state initiatives. Sitting at the national level, not possible for us to reach out to each village and ensure that their plans are made. But definitely we do handholding for states and UTs, and the states have to further take it downwards. All right. Like I was mentioning, how UP government has taken it up. What they did was, for each district, they requested some of their Panchayati Raj members to be part of such training programs online. And from here, from this particular 2021, we are taking up training of trainer programs for UP government. Okay, which is based on this backdrop itself of this, the kind of webinar that we've just hosted for Puducherry. So what we can do is, we can invite people like you. You can, if you have that bent for that, training and capacity building as a trainer element, if you have that, and the SIRDs. So NIRD is also playing a role. NIRD is taking up programs very specific to maybe agriculture, some of the rural development schemes. They have, NIRD has a cell working on Panchayati Raj institution research required on various aspects of rural development for them. But as national institutes and state institutes working on disaster management, we need to have that integrated approach. Okay, so we can train. We can develop trainers and master trainers at the state levels. We cannot even reach the district levels. It's going to be really difficult for us to reach to that level. So at the state levels, we can do that. We've already started that initiative. And from there onwards, it is the state responsibility to further maybe train people, like how UP, Sikkim, and some of the other states have just started. So they've started doing it for this sector. I'm talking about this integration of DRR into GPDP plan aspect. All right. If I've answered to an extent of what you are wanting to know. That is one part. The second part is the sharing part. Of course, this was a concern, and this is what the Finance Commission has named the whole, the 15th Finance Commission has just renamed it, so the fundings. So earlier, you used to have separate specific funds for relief. So you had what was known as the National Calamity Relief Funds and Response Funds and all. And now they've kind of combined it. So you call it a National Disaster Risk Management Fund and State Disaster Management Funds. The allocated provision for the current year is this much. What is important here is to take out funding from these two areas, the mitigation and capacity building activities at the PRI levels, definitely. The PRIs also have some other funding mechanism available from the GPDP perspective, all right, from the developmental perspective. And you can now utilize some of these fundings for those activities. See, Sushma, Shekhar, or even for that matter, Ramizji, you sitting at one particular level cannot even decide what would be the right requirement for a particular area, correct? Maybe for certain places, there's requirement of a lot of mitigation activities to be taken up, but maybe there are places which are so difficult to reach that initial awareness generation and sensitization is somewhere you need to begin. So for them, maybe capacity building, starting of such initiatives from the capacity building or awareness generation component would be the first to begin with. So funding mechanisms, drawing fund from such these breakups would again depend when the GPTP teams are sitting along with some handholding done by the disaster management professionals from the state authorities or the district authorities, and then prioritizing what is required. That's something I had even mentioned in the slides. If Shekharji would want to add something.
Dr. Sushma, you have clarified many things, but the only thing is that I would like to suggest Ramesh that they can approach the local ATI for conducting the programs on GPDP and strengthening of the panchayat levels for disaster management, number one. Number two, they can also approach their local SDRF and NDRF for giving them the response training by utilizing the locally available resources. So that these two they can approach, and for NIDM also they can write to our executive director so that we can collaborate with the state ATI or the state training institution for conducting say program for the panchayats, which you said that at Jammu Kashmir are at a very nascent stage because of certain say changes in the political scenario. So they are at the very nascent stage in Jammu Kashmir for that matter. You can approach the ATI and write to NIDM so that you can collaborate with ATI to conduct the program.
To add to what he just said, I'll quote two examples of Tamil Nadu and Jammu Kashmir. See, Tamil Nadu, I remember, had approached a couple of years ago specifically wanting customized village disaster management plan trainings for their state. And we had a complete batch that came from Tamil Nadu to New Delhi, and for 5 days we helped them out. And eventually the village disaster plan, the template that is developed by NIDM, they got it customized for Tamil Nadu requirements, because Tamil Nadu has a coastline also, and their concerns based on their specific concerns. Parallelly, you have Jammu and Kashmir, where I tried for almost 6 months to reach to the SIRD and have a small online sensitization training program, which I couldn't do it in the last almost 1.5 years. So, you know, there are a lot of other such concerns also, which sometimes hamper and make the difference in how each state responds to one particular area of dealing with. So maybe we look forward to maybe some work to be done for Jammu and Kashmir maybe in the coming years.
Hello. Can you hear me?
Yes, please go ahead.
Dr. Guleria, thank you for a very good and detailed presentation. I hope we can have a go of it. And I'm a research scholar and also a social worker from Tata Institute of Social Sciences. And I've worked extensively on the PRI. It's my MPhil topic and also my PhD topic. Okay, my one thing was that I have noticed a large number of migrant populations coming in where livelihood is availed by them. And they create a lot of ecological and other situations. So how do we deal with these? How do the villages deal with this kind of influx, sudden influx of population and seasonality?
Yeah. So, ma'am, there are two ways of dealing. You know, the migration population has also two concerns. One is that out migration that we all talk, you know, people leaving their own places and reaching out to different states for job opportunities, something like that, which I've noticed in my home state in Himachal, where a lot of labor that comes in from Bihar and neighboring places, and you need them also. Earlier we used to find in Himachal very difficult to get such works done. But after these people had walked in, a lot of things have eased out, right? So we cannot say that such requirements from a development perspective can be totally sidelined or be seen in silos. So one is working with such migrant population, the out migrants. So when you are working at the panchayat levels or even at the higher levels, you always when we talk about the vulnerability assessment part of it specifically, floating population needs to be counted. ठीक है ना, क्योंकि इवन आप जम्मू कश्मीर, इफ यू लुक एट द जम्मू कश्मीर 2014 फ्लड सिनेरियोस व्हेन पीपल वर आस्क्ड टू मूव आउट टू सेफ साइट्स, देयर वाज अ ह्यूज ह्यूज रिक्वायरमेंट ऑफ द माइग्रेंट पॉपुलेशंस टू बी मूव्ड बैक फ्रॉम जम्मू कश्मीर टू अदर पार्ट्स, राइट? एंड सिमिलर वाज द रिवर्स माइग्रेशन कंसर्न फ्रॉम द पैंडेमिक, राइट? दैट वाज अ टोटली डिफरेंट एस्पेक्ट, दैट इज द रिवर्स माइग्रेशन एंड पीपल वांटेड टू गो बैक टू देयर होम टाउन्स. So this floating population counting generally goes missing when you're doing that vulnerability and assessment of that particular place. If you have that accounting done, of course you will not have the exact number and figures, but if that is made a part of your planning procedure itself, when you are designing some aspects of preparedness or some aspects of awareness generation and all, you can then reach out to such migrant population as well from a disaster management perspective. Maybe to begin with, this can be done. Hota ye, what is actually happening is our initial concern and challenges of ensuring that disaster management becomes integral to some of your development is taken up by states, is made a priority in almost all states. For us, that itself is now a challenge, let alone trying to ensure that each and every community member gets the benefit of or gets some kind of sensitization and awareness done. All right, so maybe these are all small steps that like you've just highlighted one concern of these out migrants, which can be made. So from your research, from your studies, maybe you can just begin. Maybe some of the Gram Panchayat plans can have them as included in their plannings. And if we get some good results where, migrants were also given some trainings or migrants were given some sensitization of saving the environment of that place, and if there are some good examples that come out, then that can be replicated. Yes.
Gram Panchayat Aapda Prabandhan Yojana. जैसा कि राज्य और जिले में बनाई गई आपदा प्रबंधन योजनाओं से विपरीत है कि रेस्पॉन्स प्लान और हैजर्ड प्लान, जो खतरे से जुड़े हुए प्लान, दो प्लान बनाए गए हैं. कृपया स्पष्ट करें कि क्या पंचायतों के पास कितने क्षमतावान जनप्रतिनिधि हैं वो बना पाएंगे, यदि नहीं तो इसके लिए क्या किया जाना चाहिए. धन्यवाद
जी सर. सर, दिस वाज़ द कंसर्न व्हिच द यूपी गवर्नमेंट हैज़ आल्सो प्रेजेंटेड लास्ट सितंबर अक्टूबर व्हेन वी वर वर्किंग विद देम ऑन दिस इंटीग्रेशन टॉपिक इटसेल्फ. सी, बिकॉज नाउ द 2018 गाइडलाइंस हैज़ मेड इट मैंडेटरी. जब तक हमने मैंडेटरी नहीं किया था तब तक हम सिर्फ एनकरेज करते थे. वी यूज्ड टू kind of just encourage people or request at that level, at the panchayat levels, to take up some initiatives of disaster management components. Tab tak theek hai, ad hoc, it was more like an ad hoc kind of a scenario, hai na? Somebody felt the need, they made village disaster committees and teams and all. Somebody did not feel the need, so that was just left on the papers. But now, since it has been made compulsory in the GPDP to have integration of DM plans, perhaps each state is approaching us. In fact, the Panchayati Raj Ministry members had met the National Disaster Management Authority, the then the secretary, to know what can be done for this, because now it was made mandatory, and eventually it has come to NIDM to take care of that part. So पहले स्टेप में ही हम एक्सपेक्ट नहीं कर रहे हैं, और इसीलिए हमारा पहला इनिशिएटिव है दैट एटलीस्ट लेट अस स्टार्ट विद द सेंसिटाइजेशन ऑफ हाउ दिस कैन बी डन, व्हाट आर द स्कोप्स वेयर यू कैन डू इट, व्हाट इज अ हजार्ड मैपिंग, व्हाट इज अ हजार्ड इन्वेंटरी, कैसे कैसे खतरे होते हैं, क्या क्या आपदाएं हो सकती हैं, व्हाट डिजास्टर्स कैन टेक प्लेस, व्हाट इज द टर्म वल्नरेबिलिटी, आप संवेदनशीलता से क्या समझते हैं, संवेदनशीलताएं किस किस प्रकार की होती हैं, तटीय इलाकों में कैसे अलग होती है, हाउ आर द डिफरेंट इन द कोस्टलैंड्स, हाउ आर द डिफरेंट इन द हिल्स, ये सारे कंसर्न्स अलग हो जाएंगे. तो पहली स्टेप में तो वर्किंग सिटिंग विद द पंचायती राज मेंबर हैंड होल्डिंग बहुत जरूरी है. मैं शुरू से कह रही हूँ कि पहले स्टेप में हैंड होल्डिंग होगी जो डिस्ट्रिक्ट लेवल से या स्टेट लेवल की डिजास्टर मैनेजमेंट अथॉरिटी से होगी. बट द क्वेश्चन हियर इज फॉर दिस एस्पेक्ट इवन द मे बी द स्टेट्स एंड द डिस्ट्रिक्ट लेवल्स आर नॉट येट एम्पावर्ड और ट्रेन्ड, इफ आई मे यूज दिस वर्ड. So that requires some time wherein we can train some of the rural development department professionals जो rural development से related trainings को conduct कराते हैं, agriculture से संबंधित हो दूसरे area से, तो उनको हम थोड़ा थोड़ा आपदा प्रबंधन की अगर training देंगे so maybe they can help the panchayati raj levels to do so. And eventually एक draft बनेगा, the first draft may not have the very best integration done, है ना, बहुत अच्छे से शायद आप उसको integrate करके नहीं चल पाएंगे. बट धीरे धीरे सब्सिक्वेंट जब आपके प्लान्स रिवाइज होंगे जीपीडीपीस तो आपको बाय देन अ लॉट ऑफ आइडिया वुड बी फेयर इनफ. सो वो फिर आप उसको धीरे धीरे आगे चल के रिफाइन कर सकते हैं. दिस इज हाउ एज अ कंट्री वी इवन मूव्ड विद द डेवलपमेंट ऑफ नेशनल डिजास्टर मैनेजमेंट प्लान, स्टेट डिजास्टर मैनेजमेंट प्लान, डिस्ट्रिक्ट डिजास्टर मैनेजमेंट प्लान एंड विलेज डिजास्टर मैनेजमेंट प्लान. इनफैक्ट जब ये मैंडेटरी हुआ था तो इसमें ये इस चैलेंजेस भी आ रहे थे कि प्लान का आइडियल फ्रेमवर्क क्या होता है. तो शुरुआत वहां से हुई थी कि एक टेम्पलेट क्या होना चाहिए, व्हाट कैन बी अ गाइडिंग यू नो दैट लाइट फॉर डेवलपिंग अ डिस्ट्रिक्ट प्लान एंड ऑल. सो ये धीरे 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 फिर इट टेक्स. आई होप आई हैव आंसर टू बोथ मैम एंड सर. हाँ जी, यस.
हाँ मैडम, एक बार एक सवाल और, वो ये कि ग्राम पंचायतों के एक विकास, दूसरा न्यायपालिका, एक मुखिया, दूसरा सरपंच, ये जो ग्राम पंचायत आपदा प्रबंधन योजना होगी उसका निर्माण और उसका एक्सक्यूशन किनके जिम्मे होगा, क्या यह स्पष्ट है, कृपया बताने की कृपा करें.
इसमें ये बोला गया है कि जब हम ग्राम पंचायत आपदा योजना बनाते हैं और उसके अंतर्गत जो हमने अगर आपने mentioned about formation of teams, right? तो ये कंपलसरी है एक्ट में. आपदा प्रबंधन जो अधिनियम बना है 2005 का, एक्ट ऑफ 2005 says that village level पे भी you should have disaster management teams और disaster management plans formed, right? अब ग्राम पंचायत लेवल पे इफ यू हैव बोथ दीज ऑफिसर्स, यू नो द रिस्पॉन्सिबल पीपल हु आर इन प्लेस, उनके अंडर में एक विलेज डिजास्टर मैनेजमेंट कमिटी का कॉन्स्टिट्यूशन मैंडेटरी है. इट इज कंपल्सरी कि आप वीडीएमसी बनाएंगे एंड वीडीएमसी के आप मेंबर्स आइडेंटिफाई कर सकते हैं. मैंने एक स्लाइड में वो भी दिखाया था, बहुत डिफरेंट डिफरेंट टाइप्स ऑफ मेंबर्स कौन मौजूद हैं, किसका इंटरेस्ट ज्यादा है. सम पीपल मे बी वे टू इंटरेस्टेड टू बी अ पार्ट, सम पीपल मे बी वॉलंटरली वॉन्टिंग टू डू इट, सम मे नॉट बी दैट इंटरेस्टेड. सो परमिटेशन आप अलग अलग कॉम्बिनेशन में कुछ लोगों को लेकर कमिटी बनाते हैं एंड देन कमिटी की एक मॉनिटरिंग में उनके अंडर में आइडियली किस तरीके की टीम्स बनती हैं, कि अगर वार्निंग टीम बनेगी तो बेस्ट गांव के ऐसे कौन से हम लोगों को आइडेंटिफाई कर सकते हैं जो जिनको ट्रेनिंग दे सकते हैं या जिनके पास ऑलरेडी कुछ प्रशिक्षण मौजूद है, हु ऑलरेडी हैव सम अमाउंट ऑफ ट्रेनिंग्स अवेलेबल विद देम दैट कैन बी यूटिलाइज्ड टू फॉर्म अ पार्ट ऑफ ट्रेन. सी, ये आज सिर्फ हम एक घंटे के लिए इकट्ठे हुए हैं जस्ट टू स्टार्ट विद दिस, यू नो, एज जस्ट एज अ थॉट लाइन, ओके. And from here on, maybe we can take up bigger events, bigger training sessions where we can sit in, discuss concerns state specific or UT specific. तब जाके आप actually समझ पाते हैं, जब आप अभी तो हम general बात कर रहे हैं ना, जब आप specific area के concerns को लेके बैठते हैं तब आपको actually बहुत सारे ideas भी आते हैं, आपको बहुत सारे solutions भी मिलते हैं. All right. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Sushma. Thank you, Dr. Sushma and Shekhar sir for answering all the questions, queries of the participants. Also providing recommendations on integration of disaster risk reduction into Gram Panchayat Development Plan. Now I'd request Ms. Sonia Mercy, Director of Integrated Center for Disaster Management, to kindly give the closing remarks for the session. Over to you, ma'am.
Good afternoon. All the panelists, all the
Sonia ma'am, am I audible to you? Ma'am, we request you to kindly address the closing remarks for the session. I hope I'm audible to you.
Can you?
Hello.
Yes, sir.
Can you hear me now?
Can you please unmute Sonia's? I think she's
sir,
in the.
Ma'am is unmuted. Ma'am is also the presenter as well as she's unmuted.
Yeah, okay.
Sonia, ma'am, your voice is breaking, so if you could be a bit louder.
Can you hear me?
Yes, ma'am, it's audible now.
Okay, ma'am. Good afternoon, all the panelists, the first persons, and the participants. I believe first books on integration of disaster risk into Gram Panchayat Development Plan. It is all about preparedness towards disaster. All the objectives of disaster management is focused on preparedness and also prevention. But we can't prevent as nature is stronger than anything else. Always good to have objectives to achieve the goal. First objectives of this webinar was on how to the knowledge of on needs and vulnerability in pre, during and post situations. Secondly, regarding institution roles and benefits has been well explained by Sri Shekhar Chaturvedi sir. As said, for the people, by the people. So it is totally the affected community. Using scenario assessment of damages and long-term recovery and also psychosocial care, the Panchayat Raj plays a very big role, and even women empowerment too. Management can be for the community. Sir insisted about the attitude. It's very important what matters for you. And finally, Sushma Gupta has stated about the Gram Panchayat Development Plan.
Ms. Sonia, am I audible to you? Ma'am, I'm extremely sorry. Ma'am, I'm extremely sorry. The voice is inaudible. Sonia, ma'am, can I request Mr. Paul D. Patrick Brown to kindly give the closing remarks and way forward for the session?
Hello.
Yes.
Hello. Yeah. I'm sorry, really sorry. What happened, I don't know with Sonia, but she's got some technical issues. But as she said, she briefed about what Sri Shekhar Chaturvedi sir explained in all this 1.5 hours, and also about the Dr. Sushma Guleria. It is always join hands together, as she insisted on how GPDP can be taken into for a way forward in community based disaster risk management in terms of making a teams into the community, and how the plan can be implemented to all states across India. So it was really a lesson that we learned today, and all the participants, I hope all the participants would have very great exposure on the Gram Panchayat development plan in terms of PRIs. And above all, and understanding all about this webinar, and I hope all the participants will agree. Ma'am explained the importance of the conduct camps to emphasize the importance of risk reduction and tools for vulnerability analysis, as it is good to analyze and implement plans at the community level. I also would like to mention that Integrated Center for Disaster Management currently focusing on community-based disaster risk management in terms of training the communities towards disaster resilience. So overall, I take this opportunity to thank NIDM, the Executive Director, Major General Manoj Kumar Bindal, and also I express my gratitude to Dr. Sushma Guleria and Sri Shekhar Chaturvedi sir for their wonderful deliverance today. So thank you one and all. Have a good evening. Thank you. Over to you, ma'am.
Thank you, sir. On behalf of National Institute of Disaster Management, I would also like to thank Integrated Center for Disaster Management, Pondicherry, for collaborating with us on integration of disaster risk reduction into Gram Panchayat Development Plan. Thank you, Paul sir, and thank you, Sonia ma'am. And thank you to all the participants for the time, patience, and consideration. Thank you to all the speakers, as well as our Executive Director, Major General Kumar Bindal. Before I end this session, I would like to say that the feedback form will be mailed to all the participants after the end of the webinar session. So on this note, I would like to thank everyone. Again, thank you for your time and patience.
Thank you, Aradhana Mukhtan. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much, Aradhana. Thank you, Paul sir, Sonia ma'am, if you can hear us. And we look forward to working together, on face-to-face basis, maybe more. So we'll work it out. We'll work
out ma'am. Something. Thank you, ma'am. Thank you so much.
All the participants also, thank you for joining us. Be safe. Have a good evening. Bye, everyone.
Yeah. Bye, ma'am. Bye.